What is going good, people? James back here with episode 32 of From the Vault. Like this episode, go back in the archive, watch and like all my other episodes, subscribe to the channel if you haven't already, click the notification bell to make sure you get all of my new videos. Yeah, I know, the notification system's a little fucked up because of the dunce caps that work at YouTube, but still, click the notification bell to make sure you get all of my new videos. Like me on Facebook, follow me on Twitter, links to those are in the comment section below, and thanks to those who have already done so. I mentioned archive. I've decided that with the archive of episodes that I already have up and the archive of episodes that are going to be uploaded in the future, I'm going to take a 5 or so minute clip from a random episode and I'm going to upload it. I'm calling these From the Archive. I got this idea from Good Mic Work, who does mic drops. With these From the Archives, it gives a chance to hear about a topic you may have missed on an episode, as well as draw in viewers and subscribers who haven't listened to this show yet, as well as, you know, the full episode. The link to that is going to be in the comments section below of the From the Archives, so once you listen to that, you click the link, and you watch the full episode. So when a new From the Vault isn't uploaded, you'll get a From the Archive. I'm going to take a 5 or so minute clip, take it down, upload it, and there you go with that. It adds content as well as get new viewers and subscribers. And for my current subscribers, gives you a chance to go back, enjoy the older episodes as well. This is a win-win-win. But as well as this, these From the Archives, From the Vault is of course continuing because we are at the beginning of Halloween Havoc Month. Next week will be episode 33, Halloween Havoc 1995. Then episode 34, Halloween Havoc 1997. After that, episode 35, Halloween Havoc 1998. Then on Halloween Day itself, the bonus episode, The Dungeon of Doom. Now after that, you'll find out when you find out. But on to the first episode of Halloween Havoc Month. One of the better Halloween Havocs in history, with one of the best matches in WCW history. Although, as good as the matches were on this show, the finishes were... Well, you'll just have to wait and find out. This is From the Vault, Halloween Havoc 1993. Now, I've talked about this subject before, and quite honestly, by now it deserves its own episode at some point. However, I need to talk about it here since it's a 1993 show. From late 1991, early 1992, until the spring of 1996, professional wrestling here in the United States was in a huge recession. And 1993 might have been the worst year of that pro wrestling recession because... I mean, by 1993, it was really just WWF and WCW, and sure, you had what was left of the NWA, which was Smoky Mountain Wrestling and Eastern Championship Wrestling, a couple of little stuff here and a couple of little stuff there, but it was just a two-horse race between WWF and WCW, however, both of those horses were about ready to keel over. It was that bad in 93. Now, as far as WCW goes, let's just compare Octobers from 1991, 1992, and 1993. October 1991, your average attendance was 1,490, with an average live gate of 17,880, and an average TV rating of 2.4. You go to October 1992, average attendance goes down to 1,180. Your average live gate goes down again, 10,440. Your average TV rating, down to a 1.8. October 1993, and this is the huge downturn. Average attendance, 600. Average live gate, 5,280. Now, your average TV rating, it goes up to a 2.0, but... 0.2 of a point in terms of rating, is that big of an increase? Not really. However, the downturn in terms of attendance, the downturn in terms of live gate, this was WCW cutting back on everything, cutting back on live shows, cutting back on a ton of stuff. They were doing worldwide tapings at Disney. And, of course, episode in the archive about the first WCW Disney tapings, they were cutting back on a ton of things because had they continued going down the path that they were going, all those house shows and all those, a lot of things that weren't drawing money, if they were going to continue going down that path, WCW wouldn't have made it out of 1993. Now, the business of WCW wasn't doing that great at all. The on-screen product, it was a mixed bag. I mean, you had your main guys, you had some good stuff here and there, but really, it was a roll of the dice on what you were going to be getting. For every Ric Flair and Sting and Vader, you had Ice Train, the Shockmaster, and Charlie Norris, and other stuff like that. So yeah, the on-screen product, it was mixed bag. You had some good, you had some bad. It was what it was. Now with that said, on to this event. WCW Halloween Havoc 1993. October 24th, 1993, from the Lakefront Arena in New Orleans, Louisiana. The attendance, 6,000, 3,000 paid. Live gate, $30,000, with pay-per-view buys, 100,000. Now, compared to the prior 2 years for Halloween Havoc, 1991, you had 8,900 attendance, 40,000 live gate, 140,000 pay-per-view buys. 1992, 7,000 attendance with 5,000 paid, $75,000 at the gate with 130,000 pay-per-view buys. Compared to the other WCW pay-per-views in 1993, Halloween Havoc 1993 was tied for the lowest attended with Fall Brawl, tied with Battle Bowl in terms of paid attendance, tied for the lowest live gate with Battle Bowl, and tied, honestly, as bad as the attendance and the live gate was, Halloween Havoc in 93 was tied for the second most bought pay-per-view with Slamboree and Beach Blast. Starcade was number one in that. But that is in terms of business. In terms of the quality of Halloween Havoc, I mean, you watch the opening video package and you wouldn't have been able to guess that this was probably the best pay-per-view for either WCW or WWF in the year of 1993. However, you watch that intro and it should give you a clue as to how the finishes of the night were going to go, and that is just fucking strange. Now, the commentators for this event, Tony Schiavone and Jesse the Body Ventura. Both of them were in costumes, as for the earlier Halloween Havocs, you saw the announcers in costume. Tony was Jesse, and Jesse was Bourbon Street's number one gynecologist. And then you had Eric Bischoff doing the backstage interviews, and he was a Civil War soldier. Now, we open up Halloween Havoc 1993 with a six-man tag match that, spoiler alert, is the worst thing on this show in terms of matches, and this was a match that, quite honestly, belonged on television and not pay-per-view. You had Ice Train, Charlie Norris, and the Shockmaster, that's right, that was a real team, people, taking on Harlem Heat and the Equalizer. That's right, this was a match on pay-per-view people had to pay money to see. Shockmaster and Harlem Heat, three guys that the month earlier at Fall Brawl were main eventing in War Games. Now the month after, they're curtain jerking this show. And yeah, this match was not that good at all. It was really about a 10-minute nothing match that, again, belonged on television. This was a worldwide match or a WCW pro match or hell, even Saturday night on a slow week, but fucking pay-per-view, this was not a pay-per-view match at all. And thank God, in terms of matches, things got better. So, Shockmaster, Ice Train, and Charlie Norris defeated Harlem Heat and the Equalizer in 9 minutes, 45 seconds, as if anyone really cared. Next up, in terms of matches, is where things start picking up. You had Ricky the Dragon Steamboat versus Paul Orndorff with the Assassin. Orndorff replaced the injured Yoshi Kwan. Now, even in 1993, you know, watching this, it's like, holy shit, even in 93, Steamboat and Orndorff were still amazing at what they did. Steamboat, some argue, is the greatest pure babyface in the history of pro wrestling. Orndorff was one of the top stars of that mid to late 80s, early 90s time period, two were great in their day, and hell, even here past their day, they were still great at what they did. This was an excellent match between these two, however. As great as this match was, like a lot of things on this show, the finish sort of ruined things. So, the assassin, who was in Orndorff's corner, put something in his mask, and he gave Steamboat a headbutt on the outside, and Steamboat got counted out. So, Paul Orndorff defeated Ricky Steamboat by countout in 18 minutes, 35 seconds. So, you do a countout finish after 18 minutes. Like, such a great match with a not-so-great ending. But we continue with another good match, the first championship match of the night, but the second straight questionable finish. For the WCW World Television Championship, you had champion Lord Steven Regal with Sir William taking on the challenger, the British Bulldog, Davey Boy Smith. The Battle of England for the World Television Championship. Regal won the belt the prior month at Fall Brawl. Bulldog, he had spent essentially all year going after Vader in the world title. Now here, he was put in a match for the TV title, which at this point was still a big title. Now, what more do I have to say about both performers? I mean, two of England's best, two great wrestlers, a very good match here between the two, until the finish. I mean, again, that's going to be a theme of this show, the finish. As good as the match was, the finish was like, eh. So, TV title matches, you know, they had 15-minute time limits, sometimes extended for a huge match. Here, they go the distance. Lord Steven Regal fought Davey Boy Smith to a time limit draw at 15 minutes. Regal retains the World Television Championship. And I know they do time limit draws, and I know they did time limit draws for TV title matches before, but it's like, that's television. For pay-per-view, you really need to have a finish in terms of the pay-per-view match, and they didn't want either guy to lose. They wanted to protect Regal because he's the champion. They wanted to protect Davey Boy because, you know, he's Davey Boy. But it's like, if you're going to do a time limit draw, you do it on television, not pay-per-view. So, again, a really good match between the two, but the second straight questionable finish. Now, the good matches keep on happening, however, the bad finishes also keep on happening. The next title match of the night, for the WCW United States Heavyweight Championship, you had champion the Natural Dustin Rhodes taking on the challenger, Stunning Steve Austin. Rhodes, he's been champion since September after a long feud with Rick Rude over the vacant belt. Austin had been a part of the Hollywood Blondes with Flying Brian Pillman for all of 1993. Now, Pillman, he was sort of sidelined with an injury, so they decided to keep Austin busy as a singles wrestler. Colonel Robert Parker took a liking to Steve, and with a bit of Southern magic, Parker got Austin a U.S. title match for Halloween Havoc against Dustin Rhodes. Now, to think just 3 years later, both of these guys are in the WWF, Austin starting the program of his career against Bret Hart, and Dustin is a red-hot heel as Goldust. So it's like, just to think, 3 years later. But here, you have the Natural versus Stunning, and a really good U.S. title match. It's like, three straight matches, three straight really good matches. However, you guessed it, the finish, the third straight good match, but a third straight, like, what the fuck kind of finish is this? So you had Austin pinning Rhodes. He pinned Rhodes for a three count. However, his feet were on the ropes. He celebrated like he won. Then Dustin rolled Austin up for a three count, even though Austin kicked out at two, but whatever. It's like, oh my god, they did a Dusty-ish finish with a fuck-up. So, Dustin Rhodes defeated Steve Austin in 14 minutes, 23 seconds to retain the United States Heavyweight Championship. Austin would eventually get another shot at the U.S. title, and he would win the U.S. title at Starrcade in December, would have a very lengthy run with the title. So it's like, yeah, a good match between these two, but it's like, you do a dusty-ish finish, and you fuck up that finish. It's like, three straight good matches, but three straight horrible finishes. Now, next up was the third title match of the night, and looking back, it's a bit of a gem. For the WCW World Tag Team Championships, you had champions Marcus Alexander Bagwell and Too Cold Scorpio with Teddy Long versus challengers the Nasty Boys with Missy Hyatt. Bagwell and Scorpio won the belts from the Nasty Boys on October 4th during a Saturday night taping that did not air until the night before Halloween Havoc. Now, in canon, Bagwell and Scorpio defeated the Nasties in a non-title match on an episode of Saturday Night. That earned them a shot at the titles at Halloween Havoc. However, on the October 23rd episode of Saturday Night, Bagwell and Scorpio got their shot at the tag titles and in upset fashion won the WCW World Tag Team Championships. Now, this match, originally for the Nasty Boys' tag titles, are now for Bagwell and Scorpio's tag titles. Like I said at the beginning here, this is a bit of a gem. I mean, this is the first time in a long time that I've seen this match, and holy shit, this was a really good tag match. It's not the greatest tag match I've ever seen, but holy crap, this was really good. And in terms of Nasty Boy tag matches, I mean, this was one of the better ones that I've seen. I mean, people don't really talk about this that much. I mean, it's the Nasties, it's 93, but just watch this match and it's like, holy crap, that's a good tag match. The finish, I mean, for the first time, it's like you've had three straight good matches and three straight bad finishes. Here, you had a good match and a hot finish. I mean, a nice old-school style finish. It was perfect. Probably one of the better finishes of this night. A really good tag match between these two teams. In the end, the Nasty Boys defeated Bagwell and Scorpio in 14 minutes, 38 seconds to win the WCW World Tag Team Championships. After this, the next match was not for a title, but it was for something a little different. In a match that would determine who was the, quote, franchise of WCW, you had Sting versus Sid Vicious with Colonel Robert Parker. By 1993, Sting was known as the franchise of World Championship Wrestling. Sid, however, he was the ruler of the world. So the challenge was made, franchise versus ruler, to determine who was the franchise of WCW. And holy crap, the good matches continue. It's like after that opener, you had a ton of good matches in a row. Every other match was a good match at worst and great match, as I'll talk about later. But holy crap, this was a really solid match between these two. I mean, these two did have a match 3 years prior at Halloween Havoc 1990 for the world title. That match was not that good at all. But here, 93, Sting versus Sid, a really good match. And had everything that was supposed to happen happened, this would have been the beginning of great things for Sid, even in defeat. Near the end of the match, you had Colonel Parker starting to grab Sting's boot. And then he ended up started grabbing both guys' boots, and then just Sid's boot, thinking it was still Sting's boot, and that ultimately led to Sting's victory. Sting defeated Sid in 10 minutes, 41 seconds, and this was the start of Sid's babyface turn. I mean, it was supposed to lead to Sid winning the WCW World Heavyweight Championship at Starrcade, but yeah, we all know what happened post-Havoc. Next up was the final championship match of the night. For the WCW International World Heavyweight Championship, you had champion Ravishing Rick Rude versus challenger Nature Boy Ric Flair with Fifi. Now, this match, there was a lot to this. At first, it was a world title match, then it wasn't for a period of time, and then it became a world title match again. Now, at first, This was a world title rematch after Rick Rude defeated Ric Flair for the World Heavyweight Championship the month prior at Fall Brawl 93. And they even hyped this rematch as a big deal because back then you didn't have monthly pay-per-views. So you didn't see rematches for world titles the month after the first one. So the fact that you're doing a world title match a month after the first one was a big deal. However, you get to early October, it's no longer a world title match, because on the October 9th episode of Saturday Night, during a sit-down interview with Rick Rude, Tony Schiavone announced to Rude that WCW did not recognize him as World Heavyweight Champion. All other companies, all other organizations, all other alliances, their belts do not matter to WCW. The only World Heavyweight Champion recognized by WCW is the namesake itself, the WCW World Heavyweight Champion, and that was currently held by Vader. Rick Rude made his case by saying, look, my belt says World Heavyweight Wrestling Champion. There's no mark, there's no symbol, there's nothing to associate it anywhere else. It just says World Heavyweight Wrestling Champion. However, there was a period of time where it was not a world title match. This rematch between Rude and Flair was now just for the gold belt itself. It was a match for the belt, as the big gold belt was not recognized as a World Heavyweight Championship. However, we find out about the WCW International Board of Directors. It was a fictitious group of promoters from all over the world outside the US, and this international board recognized Rick Rude as World Heavyweight Champion. So now, it was first a world title match, then it wasn't, but now here, once again, Rick Rude versus Ric Flair in the rematch is now for the now-named WCW International World Heavyweight Championship. And to avoid controversy, there was going to be a second referee on the outside. That second ref was Terry Taylor. Now, this match, it was a much better match than their Fall Brawl match and a much shorter match. That match at Fall Brawl was like 30 minutes. This one was a hair under 20, so much shorter and a much better match. However, you know where I'm going here. The finish. And this one, as bad as the ones before were, this finish here was the worst one yet. So you get to near the end of the match. Both referees, Randy Anderson and Terry Taylor, are out. Rick Rude introduced the tape weapon. You know, the brass knucks that aren't brass knucks. Flair eventually gets that taped weapon and uses the weapon on Rude. Flair goes for the cover, and Terry Taylor counts 1, 2, and then Terry stops. Randy Anderson shakes Terry to stop the count, even though Terry already stopped the count. Randy Anderson comes in, talks to Terry Taylor, and then says to Flair that he saw Flair use the taped weapon, even though Randy Anderson was laid out. And then Randy Anderson disqualifies Ric Flair for using the taped weapon, even though he didn't see it, Terry Taylor didn't see it, no ref saw Ric Flair used it, so holy shit, you do another dusty-ish finish that was worse than the US title match, and that one was bad. This one here, holy shit, somebody missed their cue, like, holy fuck. Rick Rude defeated Ric Flair 19 minutes, 22 seconds by disqualification to retain the WCW International World Heavyweight Championship. Now it's time for the main event. A non-title, spin the wheel, make the deal match, Cactus Jack versus Vader with Harley Race. Vader spun the wheel earlier in the night, and it landed on the Texas Deathmatch. No disqualification, falls count anywhere. Once an opponent is pinned, they have until 10 to get up. The first to pin their opponent, and their opponent does not answer the count, wins the match. Now this feud. This was the hottest feud in American pro wrestling in 1993. I mean, the two had two of the hardest-hitting, stiffest, most brutal television matches ever seen up to that point in April 1993. The first one had to be heavily edited. The second one was famous for the concrete powerbomb that put Cactus Jack on the shelf. The only bad thing of this feud was the Lost in Cleveland stuff, in which Cactus Jack lost his memory, lived in the streets of Cleveland as a sailor. However, those Lost in Cleveland segments, those were terrible segments, and they were so terrible that WCW scrapped any idea of the conclusion and went in a new direction with it, because the original idea was for Cactus Jack to return to WCW, no memory of turning good, no memory of any good thing he did, essentially turning Cactus Jack heel. But they had Cactus Jack return, still a babyface, at the Clash of the Champions in August after the Vader Bulldog World Title match. And at Fall Brawl, Cactus defeated Yoshi Kwan in a bounty match to get his little bag back. And it's like, after all these years and seeing all this, what the fuck was in that bag? Like, I mean, Cactus held that bag so close and it meant so much to him. Like, what the fuck was in that little bag? I mean, knowing things, it was probably a key to a Volkswagen Scirocco. But the culmination of this feud was gonna be determined by the spin of the wheel. And of course, it landed on the Texas Deathmatch. And holy shit, I've talked about this match before, but fucking phenomenal match. I mean, in my opinion, the best match of 1993 here in the United States. It was hard-hitting. It was brutal. It was bloody. It was just fucking amazing. It was one of WCW's best matches in their entire company's history, and there's been a ton of great matches in that company's history. However, and you know where I'm fucking going here, it's a damn shame. This amazing match, this match, holy shit, was great, had such a lousy finish. I mean, after one of the rest periods, during the 10 count, both Vader and Cactus were out. Cactus was getting up. Harley Race took a fucking stun gun to Cactus Jack. Cactus went down, Vader got up, and Vader won the match. Fucking believable. This amazing. One of the best matches WCW ever fucking had. It ends via stun gun by the manager. See, this is why we can't have nice things, people. Finishes like this is why we can't have nice things. However, outside of the finish, and it was fucking terrible, probably the worst finish of the night, and that includes that fuck up in the world title match, but even at that, this match, you must see this match at some point. It is that great of a match, sans the finish. Vader defeated Cactus Jack in 15 minutes 59 seconds. Now, what are my thoughts on Halloween Havoc 1993? Well, got mixed thoughts on this show. See, the match quality of this show, it was a really good show. Outside of the first match, which was awful, and I talked about it, every other match after that was either good to outstanding. The problem of this show, and the problem a lot of you will have with this show, is the finishes to the matches. So, 8 matches on this night. 5 of them were fucking shitty. Like, oh my god. The finishes to these matches, for as good as the matches were, the finishes were god-awful. So, a count out after 18 and a half minutes. A 15-minute draw with no aftermath. 2 dusty-ish finishes with major fuck-ups. And, first of all, doing dusty ish finishes are fuck-ups on themselves, and then you fuck up the fuck-up, it's even a bigger fuck-up. So, 2 dusty-ish finishes, the 15-minute draw, no aftermath, a count-out after 18 and a half minutes, the coup de grace of all of it, your outstanding main event, one of the best matches in company history, it ends via fucking stun gun by the manager. Like, oh my god. The only satisfying finishes of the night were the shitty opener, and yeah, that's the only positive thing I could say about it, was the finish, and the fact that it finished, the tag title match, which was a classic old school finish, and Sting Sid, which, if everything that was supposed to happen ended up happening, it would have been a great thing for Sid. All the other finishes can fuck off, but as bad as these finishes were, and they were god-awful, this pay-per-view, Halloween Havoc 1993, it still ended up being the best American wrestling pay-per-view of 1993, in my opinion. I mean, you look at all the pay-per-views WCW had that year. You look at all the WWF pay-per-views that year. Name me a better pay-per-view that year compared to Halloween Havoc 1993. And granted, the readers of The Observer voted Super Brawl 3 number 2 for best show, which by default was the best American wrestling pay-per-view of 1993 via The Observer. As for other Observer stuff, Cactus Jack versus Vader ended up number 4 in terms of best match, which was the highest American match ranked, and Cactus Vader also ended up number 3 for best feud behind Kawada Misawa and Brett Lawler. I don't know how that won. Personally, Cactus and Vader was way better than Brett Lawler. Lost in Cleveland? One worse promotional tactic, and deservingly so. Now, if you're a fan of really good wrestling, this is a show to check out. Though, if you're a stickler about finishes, watch the matches, skip the finishes. Simple as that. Halloween Havoc 1993, great wrestling, terrible finishes. Despite those finishes, my opinion, still the best American wrestling pay-per-view of 1993. Now it's time for Golden Ring Bell and Brown Ring Bell. For those, if you're new to this, Golden Ring Bell is for the best match, Brown Ring Bell is for the worst match. Unlike the last show, this time Golden Ring Bell and Brown Ring Bell's fucking easy. Golden Ring Bell goes to Cactus Jack versus Vader in the Texas Deathmatch. Brown Ring Bell goes to Shockmaster, Ice Train, and Charlie Norris versus Equalizer and Harlem Heat in the six-man tag opener. And now it's time for your Halloween Havoc 1993 questions. You got any questions for the next topic, which is Halloween Havoc 1995, send those in the comments section below. Prince asks, is the banning Cactus Jack versus Vader from having another pay-per-view match again rule legit? And if not, do you wish Vader and Foley had a pay-per-view match in WWF? Also, do you think the concern and promise of sorts was legit initially when ROH did the same thing with Ladder War in 2007? Okay. The banning of Cactus Jack versus Vader from having another pay-per-view match. It was legit. And it wasn't like the pay-per-view providers were like, you're never allowed to do another match with those two on pay-per-view again. No, it was WCW putting out the edict that after that Texas Death Match, and after all the other stuff with April on Saturday night, the fact that they were with Disney and stuff like that, WCW put out the edict, we are never booking another Cactus Jack versus Vader match again on pay-per-view. Never gonna happen. And they never did. I think they had one other match that was televised, and that was on Worldwide in 94, so they could edit the fuck out of that match. So, yeah, it was totally legit. It wasn't, again, not the pay-per-view, it was WCW themselves doing it. And in terms of ROH and the Ladder War, yeah, the promise of sorts and the concern initially, yeah, it was legit at first, but hey, if they could make money off of it, why not do it again? And they've only done a few cents, so yeah. Irvin asks, considering the origins of WCW from Jim Crockett NWA promotion, did it make you look side-eye at them when they banned Vader versus Cactus Jack from ever being on pay-per-view again? When I first saw that after the Texas Death Match, it's like, yeah, we're never booking another match. It's like, really? You're never going to do another one because of that. It's like, you're the one that booked it. You booked a violent, brutal match, despite the fact you're associated with Disney and stuff. You booked a violent, brutal match happening. What'd you expect? A pillow fight between Cactus and Vader? No, you booked a violent, brutal match. It was a violent, brutal match. It's like, we're not going to do another one because we booked it and it happened the way it was supposed to happen. It's like, fucking really? It's like, who's that? That is just stupid all the way around. Classic asks, the Vader and Cactus Jack match at Halloween Havoc 1993 was the most brutal match in wrestling history. Can be debated. But the real question is, Do you think that WCW, if they weren't so strict back then, would have let them have one more bout with each other? Oh, fuck yeah, they would have. If they didn't put out the edict, we're never booking another pay-per-view match between these two again. In the spring of 94, when Cactus lost his ear in the match in Munich against Vader, if they weren't so strict, they would have built a program around that and made a little bit of money on pay-per-view. Maybe Spring Stampede, maybe Slamboree that year in 94. Oh, hell yeah, they could have made money off of a real-life thing with Vader and Cactus Jack when Cactus lost his ear. So yeah, if they weren't so strict, Spring of 94, Vader and Cactus one more time on pay-per-view. Brandon asks, where would you rank the Cactus Jack versus Vader match in Mick Foley's career of hardcore moments, and do you consider this moment underrated? Well, in terms of considering underrated, well, compare this to Hell in a Cell and I Quit. Yeah, it's very underrated. I mean, the Hell in a Cell and the I Quit are the two most, especially here in the States, the two biggest hardcore moments of Mick Foley's career. Getting thrown off the cell, getting thrown through the cell, and then getting brutalized in the I Quit match. It's Mick Foley's Waterloo. So yeah, compared to those, Texas Deathmatch is really underrated. And in terms of career hardcore moments, you have the Hell in a Cell, you have the I Quit, you have King of the Deathmatch, you have a lot of different things Foley's done, but I would still rank the Texas Deathmatch up there in terms of hardcore moments for Mick Foley. Mason asks, if the scissors incident didn't happen and they went with Vader versus Sid at Starrcade, do you think WCW would have booked Sid as a dominant heel world champion throughout 1994, even though Hogan was coming to the company? No, because Sid would have been a babyface world champion. See, Halloween Havoc 1993 was all about setting Sid up as a babyface because Parker screwed him, and I think Parker screwed him again at some point, which really cemented the babyface turn for Sid. And again, if the scissors incident didn't happen, Sid would have been a monster babyface taking on the dominant heel Invader at Starrcade for the world title. Sid would have won the world title, and I think there's footage out there, probably deep in WWE's vaults, of Sid as the world champion in early 94. Yeah, he would have been a monster face champion, not a dominant heel world champion. Francisco asks, do you think the Vader versus Cactus Jack feud would have been better and more suited in ECW? Oh, it would have worked in ECW. However, it would have been better and more suited in one of those, in Japan, where they do, like, Japanese death matches for a living. Like, could you imagine Vader versus Cactus Jack, as great as the Texas death match was, could you imagine Vader and Cactus in one of those Japanese death matches? Like, holy fucking brutal. I just hurt thinking about Vader and Cactus in their prime in 93 in one of those Japanese death matches. Like, holy shit. William asks, if Bill Watts was still in charge of WCW at this time, would the Cactus Vader feud have been any different? Who knows if there would have even been a Cactus Vader feud, because if Bill Watts was still in charge of WCW at this time, who the fuck knows if WCW's still around? I mean, I pointed it out in the beginning, WCW was on a deep, deep, deep decline. They were staring in the abyss, and holy shit, if they were still going on the way they were going when Bill Watts was in charge, who knows if WCW makes it out of 1993? Who the hell knows if WCW makes it to this point? It was just not a good time for WCW in terms of their business. So, Bill Watts still in charge? Cactus Invader? Who the fuck knows if it even happens? Because who the fuck knows if there's even a company? Johan asks, isn't Halloween Havoc 93 one of the first WCW pay-per-views with Eric Bischoff as head of talent exchange? No. He wasn't head of talent exchange. Eric Bischoff was executive producer of WCW. So yeah, this was one of Eric Bischoff's first WCW pay-per-views as executive producer, but he was not head of talent. Know Your Role asks, did Dustin Rhodes suck? I mean, the experiment in 1993 for the United States Heavyweight Championship didn't work, and was WCW pulling the trigger for him to win the world title since he was Dusty's son? Oh, and what did you think of the intro for the show? Okay, as far as Dustin Rhodes, look, yes, he was given an opportunity because he was Dusty's kid. I mean, Dusty was the booker, he's Dusty's kid, so yeah, he was given an opportunity. However, just because you're given an opportunity does not fucking mean shit. Dustin Rhodes had to work twice as hard as anybody else because he was Dusty's kid. And Dustin, he had talent to back it up. I mean, you know, him winning the world title, I think it wouldn't have worked in 93. But him as the U.S. champion, I thought it was okay. It's like, Dustin in a certain spot worked at that point. But if he would have been pushed to that world title, which, I mean, looking back at how WCW was at that point, I'm shocked he wasn't world champion at some point, even with the big gold belt when there was the two world titles. I'm shocked Dustin didn't win one of those. But him as the U.S. champion, I personally thought it worked. Dustin, he didn't suck. He had the talent to back up his push. Yes, he was Dusty's son, and yes, he was given an opportunity, but you have to have talent to back it up, and you have to work twice as hard as everybody else because you are the son of a legend. And the intro to the show, all I have to say is watch the intro for yourself. And all of you out there, just type in Halloween Havoc 1993 intro into YouTube. You'll find it. Just watch it and share your thoughts on that in the comments section below, because holy shit, fucking strange, which should have been a precursor to all the finishes on this night. And Alex closes this out by asking, how much do you think the Cactus Jack versus Vader match inspired ECW? None. I mean, look, ECW, well, first, ECW at this point, it was around. It was just Eastern Championship Wrestling, and at this point, Paul Heyman had just taken over. As far as ECW goes, ECW took inspirations from other places, like FMW, most importantly, but Paul Heyman's vision of ECW was to be the alternative, to be different than WWF and WCW, to be the new wave, be the new breed, no pun intended on that shitty-ass ECW, but to be different than everything else. And yeah, it just happened to have hardcore wrestling, but it also had some of the best wrestling in the States, some of the best wrestling in the world. Yes, Cactus Invader, great hardcore match, but I don't think any of it inspired ECW at all. The inspiration for ECW came from other places, as well as Heyman's vision of wanting to be different than everybody else. So thanks for that question. Thanks to everyone who sent in questions. I get a ton of questions every week for every topic. Thanks to each and every one of you who sends in questions. Much appreciated. Remember, if you got any questions about Halloween Havoc 1995, send those in the comments section below. Don't forget to check out From the Archive on this channel, as well as the From the Vault Archive as well. Remember to like and subscribe. Click that bell. Thanks to those who have already done so. And until next time, peace.